video is sponsored by CuriosityStream. Hey, welcome to 12 Tone. Repetition does weird things to the human brain. Like, right now I'm just talking and it sounds normal, but repeated phrases sometimes behave so strangely that they almost start to transform. Repeated phrases sometimes behave so strangely.
Okay, that's enough of that, but quick question. Did it sound like I was singing just then? Did you at least hear a melody? I mean, check this out. To my ears, at least, that's definitely what I was singing, even though I wasn't actually singing at all. Like most perception tricks, this won't work for everyone, so don't worry if you just heard speech, but studies show that for many listeners, somewhere in those repeating phrases, something changed. So, why? This is called the speech-to-song illusion, and it was first discovered by accident by UCSD psychology professor Diana Deutsch. Deutsch is an expert on auditory illusions, and in 1995, she was putting the finishing touches on an instructional CD called Musical Illusions and Paradoxes. She was dialing in the final mix, and in order to do that, she'd grabbed a random phrase and set it on loop while she played with settings. Pretty quickly, though, she noticed that the definitely spoken phrase she'd picked was starting to sound a lot like singing, which, as you might imagine, was pretty interesting to an expert on auditory illusions. She featured the phenomenon on her next CD, Phantom Words and Other Curiosities, in 2003, and in 2011, along with Trevor Henthorne and Rachel Lapidus, she published a full paper on it with the experiments and everything. The first test was pretty straightforward. They brought a group of people in and played them the phrase over and over, asking them to rate it on a scale from 1 to 5, where 1 was exactly like speech and 5 was exactly like singing, and given that I'm bothering to make a video about this, you can probably guess the results here. After one iteration, the average score was pretty close to 1, meaning everyone heard it as speech. However, after 10 repetitions, the average score shot up to almost 4, which means a lot of people were hearing it as sung. So sure, the phenomenon exists. That's the easy part. The hard part is figuring out how and why, and to help with that, Deutsch also played with a couple other variables. Specifically, she had 3 test groups. In the first, she just played the sample unmodified. That's the one whose numbers I gave you before. In the second group, she changed the pitch of each statement, so the first one was normal, the second a little high,
the third one pretty low,
and so on. In the third group, she kept the pitch the same, but jumbled the order of syllables in each statement, so you were hearing the same words, spoken the same way, but not in a consistent pattern. And what did she find from this? Well, again, you can probably guess. In both cases, the spoken words continued to sound like speech. There was no transformation, no illusory singing. After 10 repetitions, people in the transposing experiment rated it a 2 out of 5, and in the jumbled one, it was even lower, implying that the repetition needs to be pretty exact in order for this to actually work. But Deutsch's second experiment is a lot more interesting to me. In this one, instead of just having people listen, she brought in a bunch of choir singers and asked them to reproduce what they heard. These were broken up into 2 groups. The first group heard the phrase once, while the second heard it 10 times. All the recordings of their reproductions were then played for a third group, who rated each one as either speech or song. And the results were striking. Over 97% of the time, listeners identified the version from the repeat group as sung and the non-repeat group as spoken, which implies that the listeners were experiencing not just a change in categorization, but a genuine shift in perception. That is, not only were they describing the sound as singing, they were actually hearing it in a way that sounds like singing. That may seem obvious, but let's compare it to another repetition-based illusion, semantic satiation. This is where if you hear the same word enough times, it stops sounding like a real word. So like if I made you listen to me saying music 100 times, you might lose track of its meaning, but if I asked you to tell me what you heard, the thing you said would still probably sound like a word to me. But this is just the tip of the iceberg. We've got recordings now, which means we can compare the actual sounds. Specifically, we can look at the pitch of each reproduction. English isn't a particularly tonal language, so specific frequencies don't carry much semantic meaning. As such, if I say a sentence and ask you to repeat it back, you're not likely to do it with the exact same notes I did. Instead, you'll adjust it to your comfortable speaking range because that's just how you talk. And the specific intervals are also unlikely to be preserved. You'll probably have the same basic contour, but you're not going to worry about the exact amount my voice rose or fell on any given syllable. That's just not how it works. And when we look at the reproductions in Deutsch's experiment, that's what we see. I mean, there's some range similarity because the test subjects were all choir singers with relatively high voices in order to match the recording, but when they only had one listen, the end results still varied wildly. However, when they had 10 listens, all the singers converged on a single melody. In fact, on her website, Deutsch has a clip of all the recordings played simultaneously, and it straight up sounds like a chorus. But, and this is my favorite part of the result, the melody they converged on wasn't the original melody. At least, not quite. The researchers compared the notes the singers sang adding to the pitches from the original spoken phrase, and it was close, but they also compared it to a hypothetical melody they'd written based on it in the key of B major, and it was significantly closer. The singers had heard an arbitrarily moving human voice, but had produced not the movement of that voice, but a strongly tonal melody inspired by it. Effectively, not only were they hearing the line as a melody, but they were mentally adjusting it into a better one, or at least one that would be more familiar to their Western-trained ears. That's amazing. Of course, as a singer myself, I do have to add a quick caveat to that. Singers spend a lot of time building muscle memory for specific notes and intervals, so it's possible that the transformation to a strong tonal melody took place not at the perception stage, but at the reproduction. That is, they may have heard it as the notes it was, but then when they went to sing it, it came out as the notes they were most familiar with. I doubt that's the whole story, but it's probably part of it. Anyway, after Deutsch and her collaborators published, a lot of other psychologists started looking into the effect. I don't have time to cover them all, but there's a couple more I want to highlight. In 2014, Falk, Rathke, and Dalabella published a paper where they tried to identify the specific characteristics of speech that made the illusion possible. That is, did it always happen, or did it depend on the structure of the phrase or the sound of the speaker's voice? They tried two pitch-based and two rhythmic variations and found that while the rhythmic variations had no significant impact on whether or not the transformation occurred, the pitch-based ones definitely did. The strongest impact was tonal stability. Effectively, if every syllable was sliding around in pitch, it's harder to hear a real melody. They also found a marginal difference when they added in some perfect fifths to prompt the listener to hear things tonally. On the surface, this is, again, obvious. If you make something sound more melodic, you're more likely to hear it as a melody. I mean, duh. But playing around with these sorts of variables helps us better understand what sounding more melodic actually means. This study also had another interesting twist. In Deutsch's version, they only compared the results after 1 and 10 listens, but here the authors looked at participants' ratings after every repeat, so they could measure not just whether or not the transformation took place, but also when, and they found that Deutsch's initial estimate of 10 was really conservative. If the transformation was going to occur, it usually happened around the 3rd to 5th time through, which means our brains are abandoning the speech interpretation really quickly. They also found some other cool results here. For starters, while the rhythmic changes they made had no significant impact on whether the illusion worked, they did have an impact on how long it took. But the best part is that these results directly address a concern I had with Deutsch's test. You see, in both of Deutsch's experiments, she'd only used participants with a minimum 5 years of musical experience, a group that, as you might imagine, is unusually good at recognizing melodies. This was fine for an initial study, but it does mean that it's hard to generalize her results. On the other hand, this new study included both musicians and non-musicians and found that there was, in fact, a negative correlation. People with more musical training took longer to experience the illusion. The authors don't go into why, but my guess is that we're just more familiar with what music is, quote, supposed to sound like. Which brings me to the final experiment I want to talk about from a 2015 paper by Margulis, Simchi Gross, and Black, which looked exclusively at non-musicians. The authors here were interested in seeing how language affects the illusion, so they gathered a bunch of native English speakers and played them repeated phrases in 7 different languages: English, Catalan, Portuguese, French, Croatian, Hindi, and Irish. The theory was that some of these languages, like Portuguese, would be easier for native English speakers to pronounce, whereas others, like Hindi, would be more difficult, and they wanted to see if that had an impact. And it did, quite a lot in fact. The harder the language was for the listeners to pronounce, the stronger the illusion was. The difference in ratings on the hard languages was more than double the difference on the easy ones, which implies that the less familiar we are with certain vocalizations, the more easily we accept them as music. And to be clear, they also double-checked their assumptions about which languages were hard by asking the participants to rate them, so we can be fairly certain that the categories are accurate. So what's the point of all this? Well, we've known for a long time that speech and singing are different, but what we've struggled to nail down is what exactly that difference is. For the most part, it's been assumed that the answer lies in their acoustic properties. Singing contains longer, more stable pitches that tend to move in clear, predictable patterns, while speech involves sudden, unstructured frequency slides and more pronounced changes in harmonics caused by strongly enunciated consonants. But the speech-to-song illusion challenges that interpretation. Again, at the beginning, the repeated phrases were acoustically identical, and yet over time, the spoken words became sung. If the difference between speech and singing is all down to acoustic properties, that shouldn't be possible. Maybe this all comes down to our old friend semantic satiation. If I say a word over and over, the part of your brain responsible for interpreting its meaning just gets bored and shuts down. It's possible the same thing is happening here. If the phrase repeats enough times, the part of your brain that processes speech recognizes that it's clearly not trying to convey speech-based information anymore, so they step aside and let someone else have a go at making sense of it. Or maybe not. Maybe it's something else entirely. The human brain is weird and difficult to understand. There's lots of factors at work here, and the first papers on this phenomenon are about a decade old. This is spicy new science, hot off the presses, and there's a lot more work to be done before we can can fully explain what's going on. But in the meantime, it's a good reminder that any attempt to rigidly define what is and isn't music is probably going to fail in the face of human perception, because human perception is really, really complicated. And that's it, but before you go, I want to tell you about a cool thing I did and how it relates to this video's sponsor, CuriosityStream. As you may know, some friends and I recently launched our own streaming service called Nebula, featuring lots of YouTube's top educational creators, including Polyphonic, Lindsay Ellis, Braincraft, and Legal Eagle. Oh, and for some reason, me. We put a lot of work into it, and we're all really proud of the result. It's been a great place to just, like, experiment with ideas outside of YouTube's ecosystem, so we don't have to deal with the algorithm, or demonetization, or worst of all, getting our verification checkmarks taken away. We've also been using it to develop formats that just don't work elsewhere, including a really cool series called Working Titles, where every episode, a different creator breaks down their favorite TV intro sequence. Polyphonic did Game of Thrones, Patrick Willems did X-Men, I have my episode on The Prisoner coming out in a little while. It's been really interesting to see how everyone approaches the problem, and it wouldn't have happened without Nebula. So what does this have to do with CuriosityStream? Well, they love educational content and educational creators, so they seemed like natural allies for Nebula's mission, and just recently we worked out a deal where if you sign up for CuriosityStream with the link in the description, not only will you get a 1 month free trial for CuriosityStream, you'll also get a Nebula subscription for free. And to be clear, that Nebula subscription is not a trial, it's free for as long as you're a CuriosityStream member, which means that for less than 20 bucks a year, not only do you get unlimited access to CuriosityStream's massive library of gorgeous high-budget documentaries, including a great one about music psychology called Inside the Virtuoso's Brain, you'll also get to enjoy the private playground for YouTube's best educators for no additional charge. It's a phenomenal value. Anyway, thanks for watching, and thanks to our Patreon patrons for making these videos possible. If you want to help out and get some sweet perks like sneak peeks of upcoming episodes, there's a link to our Patreon on screen now. You can also join our mailing list to find out about new episodes. Like, share, comment, subscribe, and above all, keep on rocking.